Alright. Hi everybody, and welcome once again to Emma Void's Let's Play of Pyre. So we just finished off another of the rites, and looks like the Lone Minstrel wants to talk about something. Let's see. Greetings, reader. It is good that you are here, for there is something that I wish to tell you privately. If you have a moment, I shall not keep you long, though I know your time is precious. Alright, well, let's tell us something of the rites. See what he has to say. You bid him to continue and make clear your interest in whatever he has to say. Very well, and thank you for your time. And I should further note, matters that pertain directly to the rites I must reveal to you alone, for thus I am obliged. In any case, when you confronted the withdrawn and Witch Udmilde, you might recall she tended to invoke a certain name. Islak, the Astralborn. I hesitate to say it even now. You would be forgiven if you took the ravings of Udmilde for mere nonsense. However, her words, as it turns out, ring with a certain truth. Before the union of the Eight Scribes, when first they found themselves here in the Downside, this land was even less hospitable, if that can be believed. It was ruled over by the Greater Titans. The one called Islak was the eldest, most fearsome of the lot. Greater Titans. Colossal monsters that once roamed the Downside. Scribes together slew them one by one and through this forged their bonds. Just the same, the scribes managed to defeat it. They later used Islak's own hide and ichor to bind the Book of Rites. However, Islak did not truly die, for by some accounts, it seems to be incapable of death. The creature is regenerating, even now, though very, very slowly. Its vow is to devour this land and everything in it. Only then can it return unto whatever plane that banished it to ours. So, in a way, it is an exile, just like you. If ever should the creature be reborn, it shall be many ages hence. Thus, the ravings of Udmilde are more or less inconsequential for the while. Yet, the history of Islak is inexorably linked to the rites, and therefore must be known. I trust your research of the book shall lead you to discover more in time. I hope all of this is of some reassurance, and now I leave you to your more immediate concerns. I shall go check to see how everyone is faring at this time. He heads out into the evening, bidding you a good rest of the evening. Alright. Well, that's about all we've got to do in here. You know, I wanted to take a look. Because I think there's like a... Maybe a achievement for playing something off of this. Yep. White loot achievement unlocked. Also, Bay's theme music is awesome, and I love it. But let's continue on. Alright, so we're headed to Big Bertrude's, a small bog dweller outpost. Alright, because we have to go across the sea. Also, by the way, sorry if I'm still sort of phlegmy. I'm still getting over being sick. This is the place. Let us go to see my client's companion as soon as you are ready. Alright, well, let's... Anybody to talk to? No, doesn't look like it. Let's go for it! Big Bertrude's is a sickly gathering of bog dwellers who stay within shadows, yet you can feel their eyes surveying everything. The lone minstrel steps forward. Sandalwood sent us. Those words are enough to make the bog dwellers snap to attention. They emerge from the mud and dark and begin inspecting your black wagon with their strange tools. One of the bog dwellers slithers forth. She is larger than the rest, and leaves no doubt that she commands the others. Thou speakest the name Sandalwood. We would know his whereabouts. Reveal them to us. Good day to you, Big Bertrude. It is a pleasure to meet you at last, for Sandalwood always spoke highly of you and your handiwork. Bog dweller once feared and respected in the Commonwealth for her sorcerous work. He did he? In turn, we know who thou must be. Yet thou speakest of the past. Sandalwood, doth he yet live? Speak plain and quickly. To be quite frank with you, madam, I do not know for certain, for I have been apart from him for some time, carrying out his will. Though I have every faith that I, Sandalwood, lives. As for his current whereabouts, I understand that he awaits us somewhere near Wakingwood, beyond the waters. A labyrinth of a forest on the western half of Black Basin, few know their way around it. The path to the sacred Mount Elodiel lies far beyond these suffocating woods. Interesting. We wish to seek him there, though, as you can see, our wagon is ill-suited for the task. The one called Bertrude frowns at this, studying the lone minstrel all the while. Indeed. Then leave us. Return at dawn. That is all. By your grace, Big Bertrude. The lone minstrel turns away, but Hedlund stops him. Hold on. Are you sure about this? Leaving the wagon in their care? All should be in accordance with my client's plan. You keep calling Sandalwood your client. He must reward you well. I, in a manner of speaking, he helped me find a sense of purpose I thought lost. Hedwin nods at this, then turns to you. Well, my friend, I guess we'll see what happens, right? I'm off to let the others know. You find yourself with time for your vocations while the bog dwellers go about their business. Alright, vocations. So let's see. Valuables. Hone reader skills. Those are pretty important. Probably what I'm gonna go for. Or a mentor companion. Yeah, that would just boost their rank, so I'm more worried about studying. You excuse yourself from the others to go pore over the Book of Rites and its mysteries. Through greater understanding comes the reader's influence. Alright, so we did. Yeah. Teachings and their wisdom first. So do you wanna do prowess or power? Tenacity or celerity, quickness, presence. Let's probably go with the quickness. You concentrate on your knowledge of the 8 scribes and how together they compose the Book of Rites among their many feats. Inspiration comes to you in a flash, whether from the book or from within, you cannot tell. Ta-da! Each rank raises your fellow exiles' quickness, making them all move faster. Awesome. At some point though, probably next time I get a chance, I might want to stop and hang out with one of the other characters. Just to see if I can get some more story out of them. The lone minstrel finds you early the next day. Reader, it is ready. Please, come have a look. The others are already there. Alright, let's take a look. The black wagon appears different now than it did even a day before. The hull is fully sealed and reinforced, and all manner of nautical equipment adorns the port side. Wow! You people seeing this? I'm gonna have a look around. The wagon should be fit for sea voyage. Let us depart at your earliest convenience. What about Big Bertrude? She then appears, as if on cue. Tell that Sandalwood he owes us twice over. If I may, Big Bertrude, you could tell him yourself if you wish to accompany us in our voyage north. Our group would welcome someone of your vast experience. Dare thee make flirtations upon us? I don't think that's what he was trying to do. No, I... Enough. But should he see that Sandalwood, tell him also to come and visit us again. Now. Be gone from here, and tell no one that we were paid in favors. She slithers off without another word. Soon, the lone minstrel breaks the silence. We are fortunate that she assisted us, but we should go, just as she said. I know the navigational controls, and shall explain. This is so exciting! I don't know how to swim! Oh, Bay, you're adorable. Swim! Tizo seems to share Bay's enthusiasm for heading out to sea. I'm beginning to feel ill already. Alright, Sea of Solus awaits. Set sail. Wormgulf. You have not yet been. Before she left, Big Bertrude shared knowledge of a current that should draw you out to sea. turns into a boat. Awesome. Worm Gulf. You and your companions watch the sea as your wagon rolls over the gentle waves. We have crossed into Worm Gulf. I hope that all of you are acclimating well. The tempestuous sea of Solus lies beyond this death-still body of water. Exiled worms from the Sea Dominion naturally congregate around here. And there is no acclimating to these worm-infested waters. We risk everything to sail here. Exiled worms, Sea Dominion, seek out cold of downside seas. Known for being reckless and single-minded, they were perfectly suited to fill the Commonwealth's front lines. Interesting. So there's another character species that we haven't encountered yet. As long as we follow the cold current Big Gertrude indicated, we shall be safe. If the next rite is in the middle of the sea, how will our adversaries meet us there? They shall find their way, as we find ours. It is all part of the scribe's design. Now, reader, please confirm the next point on our sea journey. We seek the Hulk of Oars. A carcass of... Oh yeah, I think we already saw that one. I wonder why it was still flashing. Weird. Alright, so we're headed over here. Fetid waters off the coast of Flabby Hands. Gertrude's instructions are to navigate the maze of moss in a curving route bearing northeast. I guess that's the only option. I love how the wagon just bounces occasionally. It's ridiculously adorable. Also, I'm not sure if all of those are like bones? Giant bones? Or what's the deal with them? The wagon continues rolling gently across the waves, which seems to you a welcome change of pace after having come from Flagging Hands not very long ago. However, Jordariel seems more concerned now than before and paces ceaselessly. When she notices Ruki, she stops him for some questioning. Greentail, how is he doing? Who, Hedwyn? Oh, he's pretty much the same. Been up all night, retching into the waters if I had to guess. His first time out at sea? His first. She turns to you. Reader, please check on Hedwyn when you have the opportunity. He requires our support, and we require his swift recovery. Huh. You wish them a good afternoon as you go check up on the others in the group. Later, you find Hedwyn looking out of sorts. Oh, hello my friend. It's just... the sea hasn't been good for me, I guess. It's funny, all this trouble just to get back to the Commonwealth of all places. Hey, tell me something. What do you miss the most about that place? Hedwyn wants to know what you miss about your past life. Your book collection? Sure, it was highly illegal, though just the same, you miss having had access to those volumes. The few friends you had. Your life was almost always difficult, but several of your longtime confidants did help you to get by. Perhaps the food. Your mouth waters at the thought of it, at least compared with what passes for sustenance here. Or nothing springs to mind. You've made conscious efforts to discard most of your memories of living in the Commonwealth. I don't know, let's go with the book collection. That sounds in character. You tell him that you miss your book collection most of all, after having taken many pains and risks to put it together. I figured as much. I bet they burned all of your books, didn't they? Those scum. Anyway, I'll be fine, I think. Thank you for checking up on me. You sense he wishes to be alone. There's not much to be done for him for now. Hedwyn is too ill to conduct the next raid. May he soon get well. I'm sorry for my interruption, reader. Please again, confirm the next point on our voyage. Well, easy enough. According to Bertrude, the celestial landmark you seek is beyond this strait. This place is pretty. I like those big spirals. By the scribes! The sea! I didn't know it was so beautiful! Also, just a quick note, these weird trees in this area, I can't help but think of, what was that? Dr. Seuss movie. Morax. The Lorax. Yeah. These trees totally look like the trees in The Lorax. It is so weird. Anywho. Having escaped the waters of Worm Gulf, you now can see what must be the hulk of oars far off the far on the horizon. Not everyone has taken well to the sea voyage, however. Tizo is wondering if Hedwyn is feeling better. Aww. He requires further rest, Tizo. All we can do is to wish him a swift recovery. Reader, madam, from this point, our voyage must diverge from Bertrude's instructions. Please, consult with your companions about which course to take. Underking Pass or Fathomless Trench. Let's see. The North Current towards the Hulk of Oars runs as quick as Under King Oars himself. They believes the Eight Scribes shall bless you here. Fathomless Trench. The South Current toward the Hulk of Oars teems with fish and other life. Tizo wants to fish for something tasty here. I like Tizo a lot, but let's... I still have to say, Bay is definitely my favorite character in this. Let's follow Bay's instincts on this one. You find Bay gazing down into the depths. Excuse me. The water is so very beautiful, and yet it's very dangerous? They always said it's very dangerous if you fall in or drink enough of it. But the scribes, they have protected us, and they are watching, I just know. Even out here, in the waters of Underking Oars, they urge us on, I feel it, I just know. Underking Oars, we don't know much about this one yet. The 7 of the 8 scribes of the Book of Rites, known as the Preserving or the Sea Sojourner, the legendary leader of the Worm's Undersea Crusade, sought to reach the edge of the abyss. Interesting. There's no denying that the North Current sends you quickly on your way. Perhaps it is the thought of reaching land again, but you can sense a spring in everybody's step. +2 quickness. The other way might have been better overall, because it would have gotten us an item, which would have meant more money, which would have meant better boosts overall in the end. But, oh well. Alright. At last you arrive at the Hulk of Oars, after journeying across the sea. It seems the next rite is to commence here soon, though there is no sign of your next adversaries yet. Alright, oh, we got a page revealed, somebody wants to chat, and we got the slug market. Let's go, see who's- oh, Jadariel wants to talk. Let's talk to Jadariel then. And also maybe check out all this other glowing stuff. What is this? Nautical bell. Among the Black Wagon's seafaring equipment, Hedwyn uses it to signal when food is ready. Silver Cudgelhead, a limbless, cold-blooded creature rescued from the sea, is fully grown and has led a rich life. Well, I guess it's... you can't see it behind Jadariel's horns. That's the issue. Okay. Little portholes for the fishies. That's really cute. Okay. Let's chat with Jadariel. Reader, a moment of your time. You ask what's on her mind. Hedwyn, he is beginning to recover from his illness. However, its sudden onset serves as a reminder, I believe. I have known Hedwyn since he was a child. Even now, I hesitate to say that he has grown. Nevertheless, there are such things that even I would never say to him directly. For instance, I struggle with his confidence at times. Whether he leads us to our freedom or our doom, I am ambivalent. Speak not a word of this to him, of course, in case that is unclear. I shall tell him in my own way, if and when the time requires. In any case, when times remind me of his mortal weaknesses, I end up having to consider what should happen should we become separated permanently. She trails off a while. What I mean to say is... you should know that I am fully pledged now to this quest of ours, whether Hedwyn is the one to lead us to its end or not. I have my reasons. One of them is him. I expect the same holds true for you. Excuse me. That is all I wish to say. Take care, reader. She nods and brushes past you toward the door. Hmm, alright. We're a little fishy port. Sorry, I'm way too easily amused by the little fishies. So, let's see what's on our new page. Down the river, in the words of Golgolanthian, the Emperor Solium Mur knew not of this, of course. His expedition yielded not the treasure he desired, but brought him closer to his country than he had ever been before. As he traveled down the river Sklorian in pursuit of greed, he found instead an inkling of shame. He saw the sunken faces of his people, heard their words for him. In time, he could not ignore it, and it proved more than he could bear. The river finally claimed him, his belongings, and his retinue. Once the people heard, I understand they cried with joy. Perhaps he ought to have perished, but the mercy shown to him, I think, is what transformed him. Interesting. Alright, let's go check out the slug market. Oh hey, you guys! Funny running into you out here, right in the middle of the drink. Know what I mean? Not a lot of customers today, so have a look. I'll give you a good deal. Thorn knots. Boosts the range of aura casting. The thorns are long dead and dried, yet retain some old enchantment through the superficial pain they cause. And some stardust. Stardust is always pretty good. I might want to pick that up. I could afford a thorn knot. So, I could sell the moon crest, but I don't really want to. Tailman crest, Jamora's fang. Definitely don't want to get rid of that. That's legendary talismans. Don't want to lose any of those, I don't think. The faith stone. I'm not too worried about that. I definitely want to keep hold of the lucrative contract, I think. So, I might sell the Faith Stone, but probably not. But let's take a look and see. So there's the Kerfang. Litter Glass. Move faster when carrying the orb. That's not bad. Extra presence. Yeah, I think for now we'll just take the Stardust. And save what else we've got. So, who do we want to give the Stardust to? Actually boost the bonus from it at all. That would boost that. Let's see. Get some bonus money possibly. Alright. I'm gonna go ahead and put it on the moon crest, I think. Because that's pretty handy, I feel like. Alright. Pleasure doing business with you guys. So, and you quickly leave before he can say anything more. Alright. So let's get on with the next trial. Having landed at the Hulk of Oars, you and your fellow exiles now anticipate the hour that the rites are to commence again. What do you think, Tizo? Don't I look just like Mr. Hedwyn? Tizo is worried that Hedwyn is still feeling unwell. Wait, I think... What's that? A serpentine creature emerges from the water, followed by several others of its kind. You recognize it as a worm of the Sea Dominion. A vast and war-torn undersea regime, home to untold numbers of amphibious worms. Having conquered their waters, the worms clambered onto the Commonwealth's shores in search of new wars. What they all are doing here, you see plain by their ritual raiments. The nearest one somehow loosens its mask.
Good sirs and good ladies, so it is that you heed the summons to glorious competition against this knight and his brigade.
Oh, this is completely ridiculous.
Well then, let us do battle now without delay. More than our freedom is at stake here, but our very honor, and this knight fully intends to reclaim his.
That look on his eye, his one huge eye.
Oh, and lest this knight forget, he is called Sir Gilman. He salutes you all on behalf of the Pyrehearts until the contest.
A once proud knight of the Sea Dominion on a self-made quest to regain his honor and Pyrehearts, a triumvirate of worm knights who perceive the rites as great battles to be won. He splashes out of view just as the stars above begin to shimmer with strange light. I'm definitely enjoying all of the ridiculous characters that show up in this. The glory attribute affects how much damage. Oh, yeah. That's old news. Yes, voice. Even the vastness of the sea was not enough to thwart your coming here unto the hulk of Orus. Orus, excuse me. Not to underestimate your adversaries here, despite their pitiable look. I am, of course, referring to the Pyrehearts. These rites are but another war to them, and that makes you their mortal enemy. This one's got an interesting setup. Your fellow exiles are gathered on the rotting deck of the Hulk of Orus as your adversaries clamber into view. Ryuki paws up to them. Say, what are you worms even doing here? Can't you just swim back to the Commonwealth or the Sea Dominion or wherever it is you're from? Ha ha! An excellent point! It seems then that these adversaries in the rites are clever, wouldn't you say, sire? Just get rid of them already, Gilman. As your commanding officer, this knight hereby commands it. Hark! This knight wishes to introduce his noble commander. No worm knight in history has withstood as many frontline battles. Doff your helm, sire, as is our custom. May our adversaries tremble at the sight of you. Sir Gilman attends to his commander's mask, despite his protests. Wait! Ah! Give this knight his mask! This knight hereby presents to you the great Sir Deluge! A noble visage, is it not? A petty worm knight of the Sea Dominion who somehow survived countless battles. Sir Deluge trembles and squirms. So, yes, you can swim or no? Ha! Of course we knights can swim! All knights of the Sea Dominion can! But we are exiles in this land, same as ye. We can swim, 'tis true, but 'tis summarily impossible to swim back up the river down which we were flushed to end up here. Nay, there is but one way to return. Silence, Gilman! Nobody cares! Back to your post! Sir Gilman hesitates, but does as he is told. This knight knows who you are, Nightwings, and he is not afraid of you! He somehow climbs back into his mask and coils up to his full height. Now, en garde! The exiles of the Worm Triumvirate take their positions as you focus on the Book of Rites. completely ridiculous. Reader, Edwin's illness means he cannot help us here. He shall be counting on us. Alright, so... on one hand, I want to bring Bay along. I should definitely bring Jadariel, because she's got some enlightenment, or some inspiration built up. So Tizo, get us some money. Ruki's pretty good for fighting, though. What's presence here? Oh, right, Aura size. His is tiny. I have such a hard time picking. Let's go with Maruki as our second. And finally, Bay. Oh wow! I've heard so many tales of the Worm Knights. I thought they would be more impressive, though.
Ginnerman, status report. What is the enemy's position? They now stand ready to confront us, sire. A very brave triumvirate they seem to this knight's eye. Brave? Air-sucking monsters, one and all. Pyre hearts, be ready!
Ridiculous.
Gentlemen, your form is sloppy. Fight them as though your miserable life is on the line. Your words do wound me, sire. This knight gives every right his very, very best. Though perhaps we do have much to learn from such a brave triumvirate as the one whom we now face. Whose side are you on? Get out there and vanquish them at once. Our adversaries stand divided. Let us take advantage of the opening. That one was definitely a little easier than the last one. I expected more from the Worm Knights of the Sea Dominion. Those worms were quick, alright, but Ruki Greentail's quicker. The sea was making me a little queasy, honestly, but we still won. We won! This knight commends you, noble Nightwings! Gloriously fought indeed, and this knight shall wistfully remember this defeat until the end of his days. Silence, Ginnerman! This is all your fault, and now, cavorting with our enemies, how dare you! This knight was but attempting honorary compliments, sire. Is it not in accordance with the rights to praise one's adversary on a worthy outcome? Worthy? This knight will show you worthy, you miserable little minnow! You are a failure, Ginnerman! Now get from this knight's sight! Oof.
What stirs now in the hearts of all these exiles?
Focus, training, prowess, the path toward survival on the Blood Border. These rites make similar demands of us.
Blood Border. Oh right, that was I guess where she served in the military sort of thing-ish. Alright, when did she level up before? Right, the double rush. Crushing heal and landing from a jump briefly stuns nearby adversaries. Or after saluting enemies deals an additional 10 damage to adversaries pyre. And oh yeah, fling the orb at enemies to banish them. That's pretty awesome. Let's go with Crushing Heal. I think I like that one.
Until the the stars align.
I really don't level up as quickly as I was expecting. But not a huge deal, of course. After prevailing over the Pyre Hearts almost effortlessly, you at last return to the wagon with your companions. There's little discussion of the Pyre Hearts, who seem to have already swam off toward whatever the wherever the stars have directed them. Instead, your fellow exile's attention turns toward your companion who was absent for the raid. How is Hedwyn? The lone minstrel makes a sound, but no words form as yet. Something is troubling him. I urged him to remain bedridden, and he simply would not listen. I am very sorry, but... Wait, what? Everyone stares at the lone minstrel in stunned silence. The lone minstrel breathes a heavy sigh. But then... Hey, what's with the long faces, everyone? Minstrel, I should wring that neck of yours. As I was attempting to explain, Hedwyn is already up and about. Despite my having strongly recommended further rest. Those that are unaccustomed to sea voyage and take ill, they are very likely to experience further symptoms if they do not remain bedridden or at least sedentary. Hedwyn is running a considerable risk of having to spend another night in great discomfort. What are you, a doctor? Nay, although I have traveled with one extensively. Look, I appreciate your caution and concern, Tariq, but I'm pretty well accustomed to discomfort here, and I had to see how things turned out tonight. I haven't had to stay out of a rite like that before. So you are back among the living then, Hedwyn. I was just seasick. Nevertheless, your full recovery requires rest. I think we all could use some rest after tonight. Anyway, thank you, everyone, for your concern. I'm sorry that I worried you or caused you further burden. He turns to you. My friend, what do you say we figure out where to go next? I'm beginning to miss being on solid ground. You follow him outside where the night sky awaits. Hey, I wanted to thank you for conducting the rite back there without me being there. I could rest easy knowing you and the others would get through it. Anyway, I'll leave you to your reading. Can't begin to imagine where we'll be off to next. We're well past anywhere in the downside I've ever been. Even Jody hasn't gone this far. He bids you a good evening, and you turn your attention back to the sky. Alright. Let's take a look where we're headed next. Okay, so we've been there. We are there currently. Here we go. Triesta, the Silver Star. The Silver Star burns bright over the fissured lands of Black Basin. Still further north, then. Not simply north. This shall prove difficult. What's the problem? Our destination is beyond the Deathless Tempest. A vessel such as ours has little hope of traversing it intact. Tempest raging in the Sea of Solas seemingly for all eternity. The storm that arose after the death of the Sea Titan, unfathomed Plurinus, never has entirely subsided. Can't we go around it? Given our confrontation with the Pyre Hearts, our chances back in worm-held waters would be even worse. Come on, people! It'll be just another day in the downside. Go get yourselves some sleep while we still can. Bet you'll feel better in the morning. Your optimism is infectious. Isn't it? You all concur that rest is in order, for the sea journey has been taxing to everyone. Come daybreak, you shall have to find a way to sail past the Deathless Tempest. Alright. Well, I think that was a good episode. So, thanks so much for joining us, everybody. Make sure to come back tomorrow for yet another episode. I'm doing my best work I can to try to get all of these episodes up before the end of the month. Sorry, I had some moving that got in the way of my usual recording schedule. But next month, starting on the 1st, which is, I think, the day after tomorrow? I don't know. I will definitely be posting a new episode on the first of the month, so don't worry about that. Alright, so don't forget to like, subscribe, share with your friends. You can always check the links down in the doobly-doo to talk to me elsewhere, like on Twitter or Tumblr. Or you can check out my Patreon, throw some money at me. And I appreciate all of you guys watching. Thanks so much. Bye.